Okay, without further ado, let's get into tonight's top story, which is about how America blew up the Nord Stream pipeline. The greatest investigative journalist in the world is a man by the name of Seymour Hersh. You might know his work. You might not know his name, though. There is Cy Hersh, known as Cy for short, the great journalist Seymour Hersh over the years. He is 85 years old right now. If only we could live to, you know, that age and have that level of that body of
mental
work.
Acuity.
Yeah. So here's a guy. The only reason we know of the My Lai massacre in Vietnam is because of Seymour Hersh. The only reason we know of the Abu Ghraib prison scandal in Iraq is because of Seymour Hersh. The deep state hates this guy. And right after he's published his reports, of course, the CIA-backed corporate media has come out and tried to take him down repeatedly. He's been exonerated every time. This afternoon, after publishing this bombshell story on the Nord Stream pipeline, already his Wikipedia page is being effed with this afternoon. So they love going after these people.
Well, may I make a contextual connection with the story that we did last week about how it's really only, you know, journalism is not real if it's done by old white men?
Oh, right, right.
Remember the piece we did last week? I refer to you about whether or not it is objectivity is a goal in journalism, and how journalism by these ancient white men is obsolete and we need not listen to it.
Now, you're not saying this. This, of course, was the, just to be clear, so our audience doesn't freak out. What is she talking about?
Oh, they know because they watched you last week present this information. I hope you did. And if you didn't, seek it out.
Okay.
It was based on a report, a industry report from over 75 news producers saying that they don't think objectivity is relevant any longer and that old white men are irrelevant in the news business. So I do feel like this was very much a prep for us to see any kind of good journalism from an older white man, and we can throw that away.
So this morning, Seymour Hersh published a new piece of investigative journalism on his own Substack. Like, he's not working at the New Yorker anymore. He's left the New York Times. He's doing this on his own. And it's called America, How America Took Out the Nord Stream Pipeline. And in this report, he details down to the exact specifics of how this attack was carried out. This was a major act of international terrorism by the United States. And if anyone did it to us, we would label it as such, right? If anyone did this to us, it would absolutely be labeled as international terrorism. Am I right? Am I right? Am I right? Of course I'm right.
I mean, even if it happened internally, they would call it domestic terrorism.
Right, right. So they would have labeled it as such. So it's funny because at first people didn't think that this story was accurate. They're like, wait a minute, Seymour Hersh wrote a piece about the Nord Stream pipeline, and literally journalists called him to confirm. In fact, a number of news organizations called him, called the greatest journalist alive and said, Cy, did you write this story? It's written under your name about the Nord Stream pipeline. And he said, yeah, of course I wrote it. So this is not like a fake story. This is Seymour Hersh, the greatest news journalist ever, writing this story. So that's the context. And the deep state will try to take him down. So let's go through this report, shall we? Here is the bombshell story on from Seymour Hersh, how America took out the Nord Stream pipeline on his Substack. And it's juicy. So the New York Times called it a mystery, he writes, but the United States executed a covert sea operation that was kept secret until now. And I don't want to put words in his mouth. I literally want to read huge chunks of this. The U.S. Navy's Diving and Salvage Center can be found in a location as obscure as it is as its name, down what was once a country lane in rural Panama City, now booming resort city in the southwestern panhandle of Florida, 70 miles south of Alabama border. The center's complex is a nondescript as its location, a drab, concrete post-World War II structure that has the look of a vocational high school on the west side of Chicago. A coin-operated laundromat and a dance school are across what is now a four-lane road. This center has been a training center for highly skilled deep-water divers for decades, who once assigned to American military units worldwide are capable of technical diving to do the good, using C4 explosives to clear harbors and beaches of debris and unexploded ordnance, as well as the bad, like blowing up foreign oil rigs, fouling intake valves for undersea power plants, destroying locks on crucial shipping canals. The Panama City Center, which boasts the second largest indoor pool in America, was the perfect place to recruit the best and the most taciturn graduates of the diving school, who successfully last summer did what they had been authorized to do, 260 feet under the surface of the Baltic Sea, which was using these Navy divers, operating under the cover of a widely publicized midsummer NATO exercise, known as Baltops 22. We covered that here on the show because we're in Europe. We can actually see the helicopters and the routine training exercises and the big ships going out into the Atlantic for these training exercises. They planted under this Baltops 22 in the summer, they planted remotely triggered explosives that 3 months later destroyed three of the four Nord Stream pipelines, according to a source with direct knowledge of the operational planning.
Now, he goes on to talk about exactly how this is done, why this group was recruited. Do we have some, I'm sorry, I pulled out some screens of some quotes. If we could take a look at the part about why it was the Navy. We don't have to. You can just read it up.
Okay, sure.
It's this part. You can just search it. So he talks about why exactly they decided to use the Navy and not any special operations. He says there was a vital bureaucratic reason for relying on the graduates of the center's hardcore diving school in Panama City. The divers were Navy only, not members of America's Special Operations Command, whose covert operations must be reported to Congress and briefed in advance to the Senate and House leadership. The so-called Gang of Eight. The Biden administration was doing everything possible to avoid leaks as the planning took place in 2021 and into the first months of 2022. Now, you have to think that if they had actually gone around through proper channels and received permission from Congress and the Gang of Eight, there would have been leaks, especially in a year when we saw Supreme Court leaks. Yes, absolutely, we would have known about this, but this was sort of a workaround in order to keep this top secret. He talks about the reasons why, and I think we can all agree on what the reasons were, about sabotaging Russia, about sabotaging cheap energy to Europe, affordable energy, to sort of bring Germany into the fold of Western sanctions and weaponizing of Ukraine. He says just right here, if you can find this part, the administration's attention was once again, I'm just going to let you find it for a second, was focused on Nord Stream because as long as Europe remained dependent on the pipelines for cheap natural gas, Washington was afraid that countries like Germany would be reluctant to supply Ukraine with the money and weapons it needed to defeat Russia. So for all of the conjecture we had about sabotaging certain partners, this is not something I think we considered very much. Is that Europe would be loath to cross Russia while these pipelines were still in place. Because Europe at the time, you recall, all throughout last summer, was talking to big game saying, we have these pipelines, they're great, we're not going to turn them on because we're upset with Russia about Ukraine. So they're there, they're fine, we're not going to turn it on. We're fine without you, no worries. But it was, and we talked a lot about how that temptation was there, that the Biden administration was worried that the temptation would get too great, that people would suffer too much, and they would eventually just turn on the spigot. Yeah. But he is saying that not only that, to remove the temptation, but also to make sure that there was no way that they would be reluctant to cross Russia.
So they wanted Germany to basically be cornered here and then to take off the table cheap Russian natural gas to Germany, right? So that Germany would be forced to buy your American natural gas, and Europe in general would be forced to buy American natural gas. And they used Norway as the staging ground. One of the big players in all this was Norway. They knew that Norway could be, you know, was a big piece of this in all of this. Also, the big players, we can go through the Norway thing in a second, but I think the big players from the United States side are key. Jake Sullivan, Ned Price, Victoria Nuland. These guys were at the heart of this organization, the planners of this. And what's amazing is how many times they got up and lied to our faces about this. Right. Anthony Blinken, particularly, who lied to our faces and said the United States had nothing to do with this. Well, we knew on this show right from the very beginning that the United States was tied to this. Of course they were. Any idiot would know better than that. Of course, you had a lot of idiots that were marched out on CNN. You had former heads of the CIA marched out on the CNN and saying, no, it was clearly Russia's fault. It's clearly Russia's fault. Do we have that full screen from Russia, which almost immediately they called out and confirmed exactly what the United States, what Seymour Hersh has said in his reporting about the Baltops 22 plan over the summer. Here's what the Russian embassy at the time said. We note the attempts by some U.S. legislators to put blame on Russia for the incidents that occurred on Nord Stream 1 and 2 gas pipelines. Perhaps they have a better view from the top of Capitol Hill. But if that's the case, they must also have seen the U.S. warships activities at the very site of the Russian infrastructure disruption just the day before. Or noticed drones and helicopters fly over there, or observed U.S. Navy exercises with underwater explosives that had been conducted in the same area some time ago, meaning that summer. Finally, they should have recalled the promises made by President Biden to bring an end to the Nord Stream 2 project. And if you need a reminder of President Biden calling for the end of the Nord Stream pipeline, here is President Biden talking about how we'll put an end to it no matter what. Watch.
Let me answer the first question first. If Germany, if Russia invades, that means tanks or troops crossing the border of Ukraine again, then there will be no longer a Nord Stream 2. We will bring an end to it.
How will you do that exactly, since the project and control of the project is within Germany's control?
We will, I promise you, we'll be able to do it.
We just got a super chat asking if Great Britain was involved. They are not mentioned in this report. That's not to say they didn't know or weren't complicit, but he does not mention Great Britain.
As George Eliason has reported also, or has been working on as well, this piece and this idea that Germany was also involved, and there were some green activists, green eco-terrorists involved in Germany that were actively involved in this as well. So Germany is not quiet in all of this, but this Seymour Hersh piece particularly is just on the United States side of this right now. Go ahead, David.
It would seem that Germany would have to be involved in some way, because it's like, if this is true, then they knowingly gave up cheaper energy to screw their people, right? Or they can claim that they didn't know, but now they do. And so what, do they turn around and now take the gas to help the people that they said they couldn't before? Because, you know, it's like they're in a spot now, like they've got some questions to answer.
Right. Now, more about just sort of saying the quiet part out loud. We have shown you this piece about President Joe Biden saying there will be no Nord Stream pipeline. Victoria Nuland also said something similar. We want to remind you what she said, because Seymour Hersh said that these were kind of key components to getting around congressional approval, is dropping these hints and then not following up on them. So listen.
With regard to Nord Stream 2, we continue to have very strong and clear conversations with our German allies, and I want to be clear with you today. If Russia invades Ukraine, one way or another, Nord Stream 2 will not move forward.
Okay. Now, the part of these components, the fact that the president and Victoria Nuland both mentioned this plan, meant that it was no longer a covert operation. All they had to do was just kind of do it, because the president had already announced that they could do it. So here's what he says. The plan to blow up Nord Stream 1 and 2 was suddenly downgraded from a covert operation requiring that Congress be involved to one that was deemed as a highly classified intelligence operation with U.S. military support. Under the law, the source explained, this was no longer a legal requirement to report the operation to Congress. Because they've already dropped these hints, this was strategic. All they had to do now was just do it, still had to be secret. And the Russians have because of the Russians' superlative surveillance on the Baltic Sea. So, you know, now that they've talked about it, there we go.
And then
they've implied it.
And then, of course, Victoria Nuland came out in that Senate testimony in front of Senator Ted Cruz and was like, I'm just as excited as you are, Senator Ted Cruz, about us carrying out international terrorism. Watch.
Senator Cruz, like you, I am, and I think the administration is very gratified to know that Nord Stream 2 is now, as you like to say, a hunk of metal at the bottom of the sea.
Yeah. So in return, then...
So how did they get cooperation in this region? Well, it turns out they turned to Norway, and he actually makes a compelling argument for why they would do this. He says the Norwegian government angered liberals and some moderates in its parliament last November by passing the Supplementary Defense Corporation, the SDCA. Under the new deal, the U.S. legal system would have jurisdiction in certain agreed areas in the north over American soldiers accused of crimes off base, as well as over those Norwegian citizens accused of suspected or interfering with the work at the base. So Norway handed this sort of legal jurisdiction over to the U.S. So Norway was an easy partner. Not only that, but back in Washington, planners knew that they had to go with Norway because Norway, he says, they hated the Russians. And the Norwegian Navy was full of superb sailors and divers who had generations of experience in highly profitable deep sea oil and gas exploration, the source said, and they could be trusted to keep the mission secret. The Norwegians may have had other interests as well, he says. The destruction of Nord Stream pipeline, if the Americans could pull it off, would allow Norway to sell vastly more of its own natural gas to Europe. Mm. That's interesting. Those are interesting motives, are they not?
Yes. So this is why they wanted to pull Norway into this mess. Again, there's a lot of deep state players here. There's a lot of people who were involved in this. And does it just stop at Washington, D.C.? Clearly not. Clearly not, especially when you're involving NATO in all of this. And there was immediate response, of course, from Poland when this was blown up. So there was, you know, there was obviously deep-reaching connections across NATO and across NATO countries.
But he points out that the Norwegians and the Americans had a location and in the operations. But there was another concern is that as they prepared for this, if there was any unusual underwater activity in the waters of this region, it would draw the attention of the Swedes or the Danish, which would report it, which tells us then. And I think that most of the reporting we've seen up until now has told us that the Swedes and the Danish are not implicated. I haven't seen any reporting where people thought that they were involved.
No, but when Sweden figured out like what happened, they're like, but we have the report. We just can't share it with anybody. Like, we know who did this, but maybe we can't make this public. We're sorry.
Yeah. I mean, they have been suspiciously quiet.
Right.
Even though they've said they have an idea who it was, they aren't interested in reporting it. But the Norwegians and the Americans at least thought that they would report suspicious activity in the run-up to this, which is why we think that they were not major players. So it's to the U.S. and Norway right now. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, and it's so many U.S. politicians were actively talking about the destruction of the pipeline. Like, is it any surprise at all that the U.S. carried out this international terrorism? Just watch. Here's a compilation of just a short little clip here of a number of U.S. politicians calling for this. Watch.
The sledgehammer that we have against Putin is to shut down the Nord Stream 2 pipeline and do it permanently.
This is a real, acute, and proven threat.
I'm a big proponent of making sure we stop Nord Stream 2 from happening.
Stopping the Nord Stream 2.
And we need
the chancellor is there right
after,
now.
Assets like the Nord Stream 2.
And, you know, Trump also isn't wrong to identify Nord Stream 2, this pipeline he talked about today, as problematic.
There is still time to stop Nord Stream 2 if we act quickly.
The timeline for action is short.
And I'm not going to stop working to halt Nord Stream 2 to stop Russia.
End it. Once and for all.
I mean, he needs to kill the Nord Stream 2 pipeline right now.
And I think the most important thing right now, and what Zelensky said, is they want Nord Stream 2 stopped. Mm. That's what I see as the most tangible reason and the tangible effect.
I believe we must stop this Nord Stream 2 pipeline.
Yeah, and they did. Somebody in our chat says, Alice Coomer says, old news. No, this is actually breaking news this afternoon. Not sure if you just tuned in late or not, but Seymour Hersh, the greatest investigative journalist in the world, has now confirmed that the United States did, in fact, blow up the Nord Stream pipeline. So this is confirmed by Seymour Hersh. Of course, the White House trying to deny it this afternoon. Which reporters will be brave enough to start? This is arguably one of the biggest stories in the last decade. And the United States carried out international terrorism. And not only that, eco-terrorism.
Yeah.
With the amount of gas that was pushed in the atmosphere, they're supposed to be green, right? They're supposed to be in favor of, you know, lack of CO2 emissions and really caring for the planet.
This was a major economic eco disaster. In the president's State of the Union last night, he was talking about how, you know, we will still need some natural gas for a while. People in the audience booed, and he's like, we don't want to, right? Because we want to be green. You shouldn't be using gas. Yeah, this is the talking points, at least out of the administration, that they care about the environment, but not if they're going to do this to the sea.
And it is old news to anyone who's been watching our show and anyone with a brain, as someone said in the chat, with common sense, right? We, from the very beginning, were calling that this was, in fact, the United States involved in this, but we didn't have we had all the pointers. But Seymour Hersh finally put it together and actually has the evidence now and has the confirmation of this. And so now will reporters force the Biden administration to respond to this? And will anyone be held accountable for this? And what my question is, then what will Putin's move be in all of this? What will the Russian response be in all of this? In fact, this afternoon, we saw the lights go out of the Capitol building for a while. In the middle of a Twitter hearing this afternoon, all the lights got shut off. We've seen multiple attacks on energy infrastructure and across the United States over the past couple of months. The greatest number of attacks on our electrical substations over the past year. So what's going on here? Like, what will the next moves be? If you want to provoke the bear, you're absolutely doing it right now. Go ahead, David. Sorry.
Well, I was going to say the usual suspects. We already know who the Putin apologists are. Glenn Greenwald, the Gray Zone, Jimmy Dore. Matt Taibbi, those are the guys that are going to cover this. Those are the real journalists out here. Glenn Greenwald, I don't know if I mentioned him, us. But anybody basically who's been called a Putin apologist, everybody else, they're going to probably try to toe the establishment line, blow this off, say that everybody that's talking about it is on Putin's side. We're getting money from the Kremlin.
Right.
Seymour Hersh, I can already see it happening.
The guy who literally broke the My Lai massacre, who showed us all like the lies that were being perpetrated on the American people in Iraq and the scandals that were unfolding in Iraq. He was the one that showed us those things, right? So the track record is clear, but you're right. He's, like I said, his Wikipedia page is already being manipulated this afternoon. The White House is denying it.
Somebody in chat just said Reddit removed a thread discussing the Seymour Hersh article.
Mm-hmm.
Did they already?
Yeah, of course.
And I mean, what's so interesting is that as this really good reporting unfolds, the mainstream media has to question, why did we run with that Putin did it narrative? And they did. It was just to like pick up the football and run down the field. When anyone who was a critical thinker was like, that doesn't smell pass the smell test at all. Were you going to say something, Philip? No.
Yeah. Mark, sorry. I was going to say, I was just going to say that, Reddit, you have to be careful about saying Reddit took it down, 'cause it could have just been a moderator in a particular subreddit. So yeah, you'll definitely want to look into that. 'Cause if Reddit is actually actively taking it down, that would be very interesting, but, it's a little hard to tell if it was Reddit or if it was just a moderator for that particular subreddit.
So Mark Ames, right.
That's all I wanted to bring up.
Okay. Mark Ames on Twitter says this: expect Hersh's bombshell scoop to get smeared by the corporate media as they've done to nearly all of his scoops going back to his 1974 expose on the CIA's illegal domestic spy program, attacked by the Washington Post, Time, Newsweek, etc., but validated by the Church Committee. So he's always been exonerated. Like, his reporting is impeccable. So you just keep, they'll go after him. They will go after him. And that's what they'll try to do to discredit him.
All right. Let's talk a little bit more about, let's see, we've done the who, we've done the why. Let's go to the when and the how.
Okay.
He has questions, or he has answers about that too. He talks about how there was a Baltic operation that was already scheduled for June of 2022, known as Baltic Operations 22 or BALTOPS 22. This is a Navy exercise that was made very public. And so it happened in plain sight. And the idea was, I think he says it was Norway's idea, that like, hey, it's a while we're down there situation.
Right.
Like getting your tubes tied when you have the baby.
Like while you're having the baby, let's just get those tubes tied. Let's plant some explosives on Russia's Nord Stream pipeline.
Yes. And so they did that. And the plan was to detonate within just a few days because of the equipment that they were using. When he says at the last minute, the Biden administration got a little cold feet and said, we're worried that if this happens right after Baltops, it looks a little too suspicious. So can we remote detonate with a series of commands? Why is that funny?
It's just hilarious.
I didn't make it up.
No, I know. But it's amazing. Like, they're so stupid. Like, the Baltops operation is literally running exercises in the Baltic, like right near the pipeline. And then their plan was a few days later to blow it up. Like, anyone with a brain would have, okay, drawn that connection. Like, but just allowing a month or two afterwards. Oh, now we totally forgot that NATO was running exercises there.
Well, I was gonna say, like, somebody's like, oh no, those magnetic explosives slipped out of my pocket in my wetsuit and must have accidentally stuck right to the side of the pipeline.
Yeah. How'd those get there?
Yeah. How'd those get
magnetic?
There?
So we got the win.
So we know that the when is what, you know, we had sort of already surmised was it during Baltops 22, and that then Washington asked for this remote detonator because they thought that 2 days after Baltops was just too much. So they asked, can we come up with a way to remote detonate? It was a big ask. But apparently it got done. Tasked with an arbitrary last-minute change was something the CIA was accustomed to managing. It was like, they live for this stuff, right? That's what they're made for.
And they think we're stupid. And they think we won't do anything about it. And, you know, it's like, what? We need to throw these bums out. And someone just in the chat says, y'all need a new White House. Yes, we do.
Yeah.
We do need a new White House. Ryan Clark. No, it says that. Christian Bennett says, we all need a new White House. Yes.
Okay. And so they got what they wanted. They came up with a sort of trigger timing type thing. It's a little technical, and I'm not sure I'm the right person. They said they wanted the signal to be robust enough that no other signal could accidentally send a pulse. It was like, you know, these frequencies. You didn't want like an underwater sea creature just sort of making a call and then blowing it up. Yeah. They had a way. And as you know, it happened in September of 2022.
So there it is, Seymour Hersh, how America took out the Nord Stream pipeline. Read his amazing report. You can go through it, published just a few hours ago today, but really, really fantastic. So thank you, Seymour Hersh, for once again proving that at 85 years old as an investigative journalist, you can still pull it off.
Now, he claims to have spoke with people with direct knowledge of the operation. You know, whether or not Russia says, oh, this is the piece of information we needed or not, I don't know, because Russia has been saying for months that they know that it was the United States. So is this anything new to Russia, which also has intelligence? Who knows? But he does talk about the Ivy Bells operation from the mid-50s when Russia ran an undersea cable, and the United States tapped it because Russia thought that it was so remote that nobody could possibly be listening into it, and they listened for over a decade. So there is precedence for this, but whether or not there will be an international response, which I think there should be, whether or not there will be any retaliation, which of course nobody wants to see, but we want to see real answers.
Yeah, there will be. And this is all indications are pointing to a massive offensive unfolding in Ukraine very, very shortly. So this could be the retaliation, and we'll see how this unfolds, unfortunately. But this is the high stakes brinkmanship that they're playing with, and they're going to get us all killed as a result of it. Thanks CIA. Thanks Victoria Nuland, Anthony Blinken. Will these guys be fired? Will these guys be held accountable? I mean, is anyone going to have the balls to ask them at the next press conference, Anthony Blinken, like, hey, you guys are responsible for the Nord Stream pipeline. You lied right to our faces. Why are you still employed, and why are you not behind bars? Like, why is there not a DOJ investigation into this? Why?
And when you think of all the protests in Germany of people who are freezing and cannot pay for affordable energy, those people are also owed an explanation, 100%. Right. And so will the European Union call for some explanations? We're waiting.
I thought Germany gave their explanation, and they were that their citizens were happy to give up their gas and freeze this winter.
That's what they did. Right. We were told, right? Yeah, yeah. The foreign minister for Germany is like, you know what? The people are fine. We care more about Ukraine, is what she told us all. Thank you so much for watching this segment here at Redacted. We are live every day at 4 p.m. Eastern time, trying to share the stories that the mainstream media will not cover. You should also come over and join our community of Redacted Rebels over at redacted.inc. That's our private locals community where we can share exclusive content that we simply cannot share here on YouTube. Come over and join the rebellion together right now by going to redacted.inc. We'll see you next time.